Penguin Random House Audio presents Florida Man by Tom Cooper. Read for you by Will Damron. To my brother, Michael Paul Cooper. Solastalgia, a longing for the world as it should be, for nature when there's no nature left. Robert McFarlane, from The Lost Words. We are tied to the ocean, and when we go back to the sea, whether it is to sail or to watch it, we are going back from whence we came. President John F. Kennedy. We are the ageless, we are teenagers. We are the focused out of the hopeless. We are the last chance, we are the last dance. Public image limited, one drop. Levels rising on the island shows no sign of soon subsiding. David Berman, as purple mountains, snow is falling in Manhattan. There is no time. Lou Reed, there is no time. Suspect every man, ask no questions, settle your own quarrels, never steal from an islander, stick by him, even if you do not know him, shoot quick when your secret is in danger. Cover your kill. Old Conch saying. Miami has the Dolphins, the greatest football team. We take the ball from goal to goal like no one's ever seen. We're in the air, we're on the ground, we're always in control. And when you say Miami, you're talking Super Bowl. 'Cause we're the Miami Dolphins, Miami Dolphins, Miami Dolphins number one. Yes, we're the Miami Dolphins, Miami Dolphins, Miami Dolphins number one. Lee Offman, Miami Dolphins Fight Song, 1972. Tropical Storm, A Falling Meteorite of a Man, 1963. The boy came inside the girl. Reed Crowe rolled off Heidi Caravas with a final shudder and moan and lay next to her in the gunwale of the rocking aluminum skiff. Some wee morning hour, the August air sticky with heat. The planetarium of the Florida sky, a thousand score of stars strong, glimmered down. The vast Everglades was stretched in every direction around them. Miles upon miles of black swamp and sawgrass hammocks and mangrove thickets. And to the west, on the distant shore, like votives arrayed along an altar, shined the lights of Emerald City, town of Crow's birth, the beach houses and shanties and houseboats with windows aglow. The boy and girl were still catching their breath when Crow said, Puerto Rico. Heidi asked Crow if he pulled out in time. He told her he did. The girl asked again. Crow reassured her. And he was almost certain, 95% certain. Still convincing himself, he said, You hear me? Puerto Rico. How about Puerto Rico? You're drunk, Heidi said. She stood, hand on the gunwale, sweaty skin separating from the cold metal bottom of the boat with a tape-peeling sound. She picked up her mint-green panties, slipped a thick, shining thigh through a leg hole, slipped the other leg through. To the boy, she was a vision, her fulsome Greek figure, her wide hips, her dark, curly hair, sun-kissed from a summer almost past, her blouse embroidered with little yellow and red flowers, the cotton startlingly white against her olive skin. Crow loved her. She was 17. He on the cusp of 18. In 1960, they'd met during Hurricane Donna, in Emerald City's hurricane shelter, a repurposed gymnasium. She was from south of Tarpon Springs, visiting her grandparents, a girl from a Greek sponging family, and right away, Crow knew he had to see her again, as soon as possible. And before Donna had scythed across the state, he asked her on a date. Flaming Star, with Elvis Presley. 3 years later, here they were, Heidi asking what the hell was in Puerto Rico. She settled next to him, pillowed her sweaty cheek against his chest. They smelled like each other, briny animal teenage lust. Crow popped a match and lit a cigarette. In the brief flare of light, his green eyes were smirking. Pamphlet in the mail the other day. A sign. Selling nice little houses on the beach out there for cheap. Little huts. You want to live in a hut now, Heidi said. Nice huts. Place you could live like a king. Dollar a day. You'd die in 2 weeks. They often played this game after lovemaking, talking about where they'd run away. Fantasies, pipe dreams. He had no money. She had no money. He had no plans except far-fetched. In May, the destination was Rio de Janeiro. In June, Isla Margarita. Somewhere far, far away from their warring families. About this, they agreed. Heidi's clan, the Caravases, was leery of Crow and his kin. Rightfully so. The history of the Crows, among the first homesteaders in this outpost, so far flung in the jungly reaches of Florida, was long and sordid. To the Caravas family, devout Catholics that they were, Crow was guilty by association, by blood, by birthright. Wherever they ended up, the place had to be close to the water. They both loved the water, and they both loved this place, Emerald Island. The only reason why they'd leave was their families. Now Heidi asked Crow, "You know one lick of Spanish?" Knowing damn well he didn't. Heidi, fluent in 2 languages, English and Greek. 3, counting the conversational Spanish she picked up from all the radio stations down south in Miami. When the weather was right and when the signal was strong, you could pick up the signals this far up along the Gulf Coast. "Way you learn's living in the country," Crow said, with as much authority as he could muster. "I like how your voice sounds when I put my ear like this. The rumble." Night creatures, insects and frogs and alligators babbled around them. A mosquito lit on Heidi's knee and she slapped it. She dipped her hand in the water, swished it, flicked off the drops. She wiped her fingers dry in Crow's hair. "Hey, goddammit," he said, kidding, leaning away. He smacked one of her fat brown ass cheeks. God, did he love her tan lines, her ass. She bit softly into his neck. Crow settled back, and he went on. "Forcing yourself, like throwing little kids in the water, teaching them how to swim. You've been throwing kids into pools? Hola, bueno, ¿cómo estás?" Crow drew the last drag of his cigarette, put it out in an empty can of Ham's beer. Little hiss. "Nasty cigarette," Heidi said sleepily. "I'll dive for sponges, scrape barnacles off yachts, empty slop buckets, lots of possibilities." Heidi cocked her head, held up a finger. "Juggling," Crow said. "Shush," Heidi said. "You hear that?" Crow hushed. They listened. Now they both could hear it. The putt, putt, putt of a small engine, a mile-high mechanical cough. The putt, putt, putt grew closer. Louder. And now they could see it, a small 2-prop plane coming toward them, quickly shedding altitude. They could see the flashing beacon on the tail, the jerking navigation lights on the tips of the wings. Then flames engulfed the fuselage. Metal shrieked and ripped. A rudder broke free as the craft fell farther yet, closer yet. A fulminating dragon in its death spiral. Crow saw something sheer loose from the plane. Another part of the craft, he thought at first. But no, the flaming part was moving, screaming. A man was dropping from the sky head first, like a daredevil. His arms were pinwheeling, his legs scissoring, his body flailing like he was fending off a frenzy of hornets. And then about 100 yards away, the falling man walloped the water, landing in the fringe of weeds circling a mangrove islet. Still the plane spiraled, now so low and close, Crow could feel the heat on his face, the sting of fumes in his eyes. Without thinking and without warning, Crow hooked his arm around Heidi's waist and he tossed them overboard, All he heard was her little crying yelp before they went under, clinging to each other. Then the water jolted massively as if meteor struck. A roar of sound. An underwater supernova of light. Crow and Heidi flailed against the undertow. They surfaced, gagging and retching against smoke. The wreckage of the plane flamed around them, gobs of fiberglass and plastic so hot the little fires sputtered green and purple and blue. Several yards away, their capsized boat bounced on the big black waves. They frog-paddled back to it. Crow flipped the boat over and pulled himself in. He took Heidi's hands and hoisted her out of the water, and they sat gasping for breath.
"I want to go home," said Heidi Caravas.
Her voice was pleading, her eyes pure devastation. Like Crow, she was shivering and soaked. Crow told Heidi,
"We gotta go over there."
He didn't like how his voice sounded, scared, boyish.
"No, no, no."
She was sobbing. She gripped Crow's arm, her fingers digging.
"Just let the police."
"People," Crow told her. "Never find this place again."
"Don't be stupid. Don't be crazy."
"Oh, man.
People. They're people. Look."
"No, don't. Don't look at them."
"Are they dead?"
Crow didn't answer. Heidi asked Crow again.
"Yeah. Yeah, they are."
It took him several minutes to oar the distance to the wreckage, and he did it alone. Heidi would not look. Could not look. She had her knees drawn up, and her arms circled around her legs, her head hung down. When they drew closer, he saw the bodies in the water. Three men, charred and smoking. Dead.
"What's that smell?" Heidi cried.
Crow didn't answer. The nearest man lay belly up in a stand of cattails, half his face scalded off so his jawbone showed through. Two other men bobbed in the water near the plane, the flesh of the bodies still aflame, their limbs skewed in angles.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.